name is Mikhail Solomon. I'm the director of Prism Art Fair. We have a really impressive group of conversations this afternoon that will begin with Minky English, Amber Robles-Gordon, and Jamea Richmond-Edwards. I'll begin by introducing our lovely moderator for this afternoon's talk. They're going to be speaking specifically about Black contemporary art movements. Minky English is an arts advocate. She's also an advocate of arts education. She's based out of New York, and she owns a company called Print by Print that essentially does a lot of social media management and distribution of artists of color online, amongst a number of other things. She also hosts a monthly brunch series at Ode to Babel, which is a really swanky, nice bar that's located in Brooklyn, New York. So with further ado, I will let Minky moderate our wonderful panelists for today.
I want to thank you all for being here this afternoon. And before we start our panel, I just want to make you all aware that this panel is meant to be very engaging and interacting with you all here. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Amber and Jamea, who are the co-founders of Delusions of Grandeur Artist Collective, and they speak to the relevancy, evolution, and power of artist collectives and artistic movements. Jamea and Amber parlayed a series of conversations about personal experiences in the art world, the cultural influence of and legacy of the Howard University, and examination of artist group and movements such as Spiral, Black Artists of DC, Africobfra, and the Black Arts Movement to build a contemporary art canon. Delusions of Grandeur is a collective of emerging artists brought together by a shared interest and commitment to their art, a need to provide critique and commentary on social infrastructures within American society and contribute to the prominence of the collective Black voice and presence within the contemporary art. Delusions of Grandeur is comprised of artists Shaunte Gates, Jamea Richmond-Edwards, Amber Robles-Gordon, Stan Squirewell, Wesley Clarke, and Larry Cook Jr. Thank you both for being here. And without, just let us know a bit more about your collective and from what brought forth the idea for you guys to create this collective.
So I was started grad school around 2005, and prior to grad school, I was looking for a community, I guess reinforcement support in terms of venturing off into the art industry period. And I came across an organization called Black Artists of DC in the District of Columbia, which was an African-based community group of artists, and you had a whole range of artists, from the novice to the experienced and, mid-career, this whole range. And started into that, became a member, went through, started curating exhibitions with the group as well. I was part of their founding group, because helped with the bylaws and all things like that, helped push it through to a 501c3. Then eventually in 2000 something, became vice president, then president of the organization. So through that period, I was also in grad school. I was at Howard University. So I got this really interesting perspective of what the art world, and specifically the Black art world, the dynamics of it from a range, because it was an interchanging thing in terms of what I was able to get from the range of artists that were there. So one of the perspectives that I was able to take away was that there was not, although the age range of Black Artists of DC was very vast, there still was not this core group of artists my age. I was one of the very few in the group that was standing in and being a part of and staying in and doing some of the quote unquote, the social work, the work. And that always was a challenge, challenge to try and pull other people into it. And I think that fact was one of the reasons that Jamea and I started to have that dialogue of like, how can we change this? How can we expand that notion of community and art? And then to see it progress into furthering careers, you know, not just ours alone, but our stance in the art world in general. So that's part of it.
And at the time, I had just moved from Milwaukee. I'm from Detroit, born and raised. Moved to Milwaukee, got married, had babies, came to D.C., and I was kind of looking for a community to be a part of. And I sort of joined BADC. And at this time, I met Amber, and I decided to go into graduate school. And it was between like MICA or Howard University, and I went to like a portfolio day. And MICA, and I'm kind of putting them on blast, but they kind of gave me a crappy critique. And I'm just like, you know what, I'm going to Howard. You know, like, that's cool. Because Howard showed me love. And so I got into the grad program. And at the moment, Akili Ron Anderson, who is a part of Africobfra, he was my mentor professor, and I was in a course with him. And he was talking about his experience with Africobfra and, you know, the Black Arts Movement. And I was just like, you know, damn, it's not as many that I know of, that I'm aware of artist collectives. And so at the moment, I was questioning, you know, why were they are they as relevant now as they were then? And at the time, you know, I wasn't quite aware of other collectives going on. So it was kind of like me and Amber found each other at a very integral moment in our lives. And we had this conversation. It's like, yo, let's start a collective. And we invited two of our, you know, naturally our closest friends, which is Shaunte Gates and Stan Squirewell. And we was up in her living room like, okay, well, what does this look like? What is our mission? You know, how are we going to do this? And so that was the origins of it.
And when was this birth?
This was 2010-ish, like 2010. Yeah, when we formally started. But prior to that, Amber and I, we were kind of exhibiting together, and me and her had put on an exhibition together. And we were trying to figure out, what is our mission? And so part of our mission was we didn't have what we perceived at the moment to be this privilege of coming from these art canons, like, you know, your prominent art schools, like your mm-hmm. Yales and RISDs and, you know, or whatnot. And so we were like, you know what, we need to create our own canon, mm-hmm. you know, and that's what it was. Those were the initial conversations. Like, what does that look like? What does it look like if all the driven, dope people, Black artists in D.C., us coming together, us younger folks, and creating for self.
I know you guys are very big on touching on a lot of social and political issues. That's how I came across your collective. Asking you to touch on specifics that, you know, I love. I want you guys to speak to more about the work that your collective and the members of your collective usually address in your body of work.
So I think that it's been really important for us to, we really believe that art is a reflection of society. It's a reflection of our consciousness. And it's been very important that we take on that role and move forward in it. Even in the work to the right, you have Shaunte Gates, which is the video, and the two pieces on the to the left and right of it. And I totally don't remember the names of them, but it's been very important to speak about the Black experience, some of the injustices that are happening in our society currently, and, you know, the continuum of that, as it has been for God knows how long.
Yeah, no, and so we just had an exhibition at the Katzen Museum in D.C. where our collective Delusions of Grandeur exhibited alongside some Africobfra artists and Emery Douglas, and it was called Art and Social Action, and so we created works around that theme, and part of what we do is, so our mentor is like the godfather of our, he's not a part of our collective, of course, but Akili Ron Anderson, where we kind of seek counsel from him in terms of guiding us. So it's like that that generational sort of communication that doesn't happen enough, in my opinion. So, you know, we are constantly having conversations and helping us to kind of contextualize what we are experiencing in terms of socially. And because I think a lot of times, I'm right at the millennium age bracket, and a lot of us are kind of, in my opinion, we have this faux idea of, like, you know, kumbaya, racism isn't that post-racial, you know, that this whole post-racial society, and, you know, coming to grips with the more blatant things that's been happening in the country, you know, we're constantly questioning what is the role of Black artists today, you know, and looking at the various movements and looking at what other collectives are doing to see, okay, what is our role today? And so those are the conversations. And of course, individually within our collective, we are touching on things socially. But the biggest thing as a collective is for us to come together and kind of put that collective energy and the skills that we bring to benefit the community.
I don't know if you guys have any questions that, yeah. Yes.
Oh, thank you. So a few years ago, I was the chairman of New York's NCA, National Conference of Artists, which is the really old Black organization. And so one of the things that I've been grappling with, and I think one of the things that are important, is the continuity of organizations and the continuation of organizations. And I want to know why you guys chose to step out and start a younger, it's not necessarily the same version, but a younger organization. Why didn't you bring younger people to an older organization and continue that continuity of having an organization that lasts 100 years, 150 years, instead of like, okay, well, it's another generation, we got another organization.
That's okay.
Part of the inner dialogue that I was having as the vice president, as the various roles that I partook in Black Artists of D.C., and it wasn't just myself having that conversation. It was our elders group or council. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, I what happened is that you just didn't see anybody. The level of investment that you would see from some of the elders was not given. It was not partaken by some of the youngers. And in my opinion, I really think that it's about this individualism or individualistic point of view that artists are being almost force-fed. And I don't think it's just about, you know, a lot of it has to do with this notion of artists being the genius, artists being this being that exists in their studio and does not necessarily need to be engaged in the same way that any other business person would. That they are not, and I think it's fed to us by some of the European standards or expectations of what artistry is, because if you look at our heritage, artists are not held in that manner in terms of where we are from, and we have taken on a structure, a construct that is not befitting of who we are as human beings. And I think that poses problems. Sure.
How does starting a younger organization
address? And what I would say is, I feel that a lot of times the ideas may not be accepted. And so it's not completely separate because we're still affiliated with them, right? And we still work with them and we still have conversations. But a lot of times, you know, I mean, and bless the elders because I love my elders. sometimes the movement that could happen isn't necessarily happening in organizations, institutions, et cetera. And I think it's sometimes we have to step out on our own, but I think it's extremely important that we are still connected with them. We're still getting feedback. I mean, we're not fully reinventing the wheel. I just like to look at it as a continuum. And for instance, with our predecessors, Africobfra, it's not like we can be like, yo, we joining. We up in the crew now. You know what I mean? Respectfully, right? And this is our fellow, another artist collective based out
over
of
there,
Atlanta.
And hollering.
Right. but they, I'm sure they understand. So I don't want it to, don't look at it as just like we're saying, forget y'all, we doing our own thing for us.
But a lot of the younger artists, in my opinion, have a more academia way of looking at the industry itself.
Scholarly, yeah.
And so sometimes that is counterintuitive and counteracts with some of the perspectives of the elder artist, in my experience. And that divide is serious. And I don't know what more, as a little individual that I am, could have done, because I swear to you, I tried.
Yeah, she tried.
I tried, and I'm a very passionate person. I reached out. I went to. I tried to pull my peers. I know, but it's good because it was a question I had been asking myself from 2005, once I walked into the first BADC meeting, to when I decided I have to release this role in order for me to be able to move forward. And what was happening is the dialogues that I was happening with my peers, we were like, there's a grand difference. And I think one of the other things is that there's a difference between wanting, I am an artist and it is my career. It is who the F I am. And it's what I experience. And not to say that anybody else who's elder than me does not, but there is a difference in the mentality that it takes to then cross over and get into some of the.
So, are you saying you met resistance from the older people to?
Not to say that there wasn't instances of that, but I want to tell you that I found more resistance from the younger people. And what happened is that the whole aesthetics, the whole academia, the whole what does it mean to create from a certain mindset in terms of, I mean, it reminds me of the whole W.E.B. Du Bois versus,
Booker T.
I mean, that paradigm was serious when it comes to distinguishing between elder artists and younger artists. And I think that it's not challenged, it's not talked about enough amongst ourselves, much less in the outer sphere of the industry versus our niche black arts movement or energy.
One of the things that I struggle with Rush, and now I'm struggling
with, work through, work with.
Mm-hmm. Since so why I got Derek, and he did that generation before that, and now we have Oshun doing the curating,
right.
And so we have younger and younger people. Right. I don't want to see Rush not be relevant
and
30 years from now, 50 years from now.
Yeah.
So I think there's a philosophy that we need to adopt once we have an organization.
I agree.
Continually strengthen
to
that organization.
Yeah.
So we have history.
That's right.
I agree.
And history is really, really. And so, you know, when I took over the MCA in New York, this is what we struggled with. It didn't work. Mm-hmm. Young people did not come.
Yes.
No matter what we did, I asked Derek ran it for a little while. He did not come. They did not want to be a part of this overall organization.
Mm-hmm.
Like the NCA that outlived its usefulness. And it didn't. It had to change.
Mm-hmm. And there's not enough balance between the elder and the younger artists that have that passion, the mindset to be able to work together to help move forward.
Right.
And it's an issue.
Well, one of the things I hope for your organization is that you continually refresh it.
Absolutely, yeah.
And we are working on that.
And we are, a lot of us, and I happen to be a teacher at the Jim Henson School of Art, two of us. Absolutely. So the education component is extremely vital because, I mean, that's where it starts at, is art education, and that's a whole other tangent. But did you have a question over here? Did you want to chime in or anything? Or that is grassroots. And so, you know, one of the things that I realized in regards to education, when programs are cut in our communities, it's by design. When you look at art schools and art institutions, I mean, it's what, 4% black folks? And, you know, the quote-unquote good art students, they're going to, you know, predominantly white institutions, which a lot of times kind of encourage students to abandon the black figure or consciousness and those sort of things. And so me as an educator, and we're all educators to some degree, it's so important. And even the whole how education is through a very Eurocentric Western sort of framework, I think our story and the growth of collectives and continuum is there. Education, then us, then the elders, and us kind of like circling around. Yeah.
Were there any other questions? We have quite a...
Yeah. I'll make a statement. Whoa. There's a lot of levels of what was been talked about right now. Mm-hmm. All right, so in terms of abandoning the black image, right, or what can be used or not be used, a lot of times that black image says, don't use it, but that's all you can use. So when you also talk about in terms of the influence of African culture, African diaspora culture, you're talking about abstraction, which then you're talking about not the use of that black image through a realistic way. But even if it is realistic, you're still talking about the influence of. With that being said, you're talking about displaced African Americans, right? that's me translating through history, right? Then you're also talking about getting back to generation versus generation. You're talking about style versus style, all right? What you also have is, you have a place right now that, I'm talking about me personally, I am truly inspired by my mentors. Who are my mentors? Preston Jackson, emeritus faculty at School of Art Institute of Chicago. Terry Atkins, rest in peace. We're talking about abstraction, realism. We're talking about heavyweights in two areas. We're talking about Richard Hunt, material. We're talking about Martin Puryear, material and process. Okay, I'm gonna keep going, all right? But what's interesting is in terms of generational, right? And I only use this as an example. As a, I have a student who is 20 years old. And I've been teaching for 20 years. So I've been teaching for as long as he's been living. Okay, so since he's been living for 20 years, the only work that the students that I have think that they can only do J.J. Ardos from the ghetto. Right. Picasso. The image. But we've transcended that, and we've always transcended that. You can't have hip-hop. Oh, hold on. You can't have hip-hop, right? I see you scratching the head, Doc. I see you. All right, no, I'm saying. My point is this. The point that I'm getting to is this. You can't have that with progression. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about tradition, acknowledging tradition, we've always reinvented. So why is it that I'm obligated to use the black image?
I don't think you are obligated to use.
You're right. I'm not obligated.
But I want to argue. So, because a lot of what we do, I mean, we come from Howard, so we come from a certain philosophy, and this is Amber and I. And you know, I want to argue that regardless if you are using figurative work or working abstractly, you know, one will argue that everything that you do should be a tool for your liberation. And when I say liberation, I'm talking about black liberation. So whether you're doing Ernie Barnes or Richard Hunt or Amber Robles-Gordon or Jamea Richmond-Edwards, my question is, how committed to you are you to black liberation? And what is black liberation? We talking about, you know, us being liberated from subjugation economically, politically, socially, from white supremacy, okay? So part of our mission, because you're speaking in terms of aesthetically and philosophically, right? And which is really important, right? But I think part of what we're interested in is what are we doing for the community? And so I'm drawing a blank of whose quote that is. And it's a philosopher, black philosopher, who said everything you should do should be a toll of your liberation. And so that's where we are currently. That's where we are currently. And so I think the challenge is, as Danny said, we don't ever have to reinvent the wheel, right? I think it's our job to look at what our elders did. What did they do wrong? What could be done better? And vice versa. Because we don't know every damn thing, right? So I think it's really important that we have this conversation. Yeah. Okay. Uh oh. Yes, sir. And define Frankenstein, postmodernism. What's Frankenstein monster?
It's very easy.
Okay.
If you know the story of
Frankenstein. Touch refreshing.
Right. Frankenstein created life out of nothing and then wanted nothing to do with it. And through that whole process, its creation, which was labeled as a monster, wanted to meet its creator.
So use it with art.
I think yeah. That you're speaking in really.
Okay, so what does that look?
General terms and just because that is the lived experience that you have experienced, it does not mean it's a grand experience that we have.
But I see it used again. Right?
But what?
I see it used again.
Excuse me, one second. So I just want to, because this is a very riveting, very compelling conversation. I just want to make sure, because it's being recorded, I want to make sure each person has a chance to say what they have to say without, you know, right. So just be, no. I'm not telling you not to say, I want you to be very vocal about your point of view. I just want everybody to be able to hear each person's point of view. So if you're going to speak one at a time is all I'm suggesting.
But I think what you're speaking to is the generational divide. And I think it's easy for both the younger folks and the old heads to say you abandon us or we. And I want to challenge all of us to kind of say, you know what, forget all of the beef and what's the commonality of it. And when I say commonality, I'm talking about black liberation because, again, that's currently what our collective is on, and that's where our mission is. And you know, my question that we're constantly asking ourselves: what is the role of visual art during these times? And I'm not talking about just with Trump just coming to office, because it should have been real, right?
I also want to just challenge those. You know, I hear you that the elders have, quote unquote, left. And I will say that I think the young folks ain't listening. Yes. So, yeah. Sorry, you know, young folks are not listening. Young folks, and like I was stating before, some of that has to do with what we have been taught. We have allowed ourselves to be indoctrinated to a system, a construct that is not our own. And so I challenge you, you know, when's the last time you've had that conversation with an elder, a elder, that elder, that same elder that you're referring to, and or meet a new elder? There's plenty of them. I mean, cross the city line. And meaning that sometimes I think that we forget that this life is a journey. It's about each and every damn day moment. So pick up a conversation with Danny, because it just may be that is the wrong connection for you. You know, one of the things that I try and work through in our group and in my work is a sense of, you know, spiritual communalism. We have to figure out how to reach each other. And it is just as important as it is in our communities, our churches, or our spiritual beliefs, as it is in our art, as it in, if you're a mathematician, and then that's your spiritual, that's your artistic, your creative path. And you're going to have to reach over a whole lot of conversations. You're going to have to reach over a whole lot of, and even more so, good God bless us, because of where our nation is. And it's even funny to call it a nation, because we are truly divided. But I think art is just a micro macro of what we have to figure out in order to progress as human beings, period. So have more conversations, challenge more elders, challenge those young folks, mm-hmm.
And we need to
students.
continue challenging each other, which we've been doing that, right?
As someone almost in the middle of generations with my age, you know, I really, and someone who's been programming and putting together art shows for 30 years, I really see very, very little difference between what my elders were doing and the generation below me is doing. I see very little difference, maybe some stylistic difference, but I see very little difference about the issues that we're dealing with. I see very little difference about the conversations that we're having that they had before I became an
artist.
That's
right, right.
That your generation is having, and the generation that's coming out of art school is having.
Yeah.
You know, the only thing that I think there's a change is the illusion of inclusion.
Mm.
That's the only thing I think has changed, is the illusion of inclusion, because 20 people that got out of Yale can get a show. But, you know, like, the rest of the shit is exactly the same shit that was going on in the 50s, in the 60s, in the 70s, to today.
Right.
This is why we have PRISM.
Yeah, come on now. Speak
it. It's exactly the fuck why we have PRISM.
Speak it.
Because they're not opportunities.
Yes.
And so it's the same conversation. So this divide between elders and young people is bullshit. It's not even real. It doesn't happen. One of the first things that I did with Rush was have a show 3 times a year, an elder and a younger person, an elder and a younger person, and had a conversation between that older person like Ed Clarke and a younger person like Derek Adams, and made sure they had a conversation about it, and exactly the same thing came out of both of their mouths.
That's right.
Exactly the same thing. So this is all in people's minds, that something has changed, and that there's a difference. There is no difference. And I've been doing this for a long time. I have 3 galleries now, and I see it in each and every gallery. It's the same conversation that people of color are still having.
But when you say like, that's the part
so
that
my first challenge is, what do you mean by like?
Every black artist no.
So this is, can I?
There's something wrong. So you gotta, now you can't just come out there and what is the premise of this like? What is it? How are you categorizing
his work
versus any other work of an African American artist?
So, but this is, okay, so with, we having a very fragrant conversation. I would say this. Because I think that's extremely important, because that's where we are now with this idea of creating this canon, and we are in the process of creating a brick and mortar type of space for that. And I think what happens when us scholarly folks, us talented 10th Negroes, what tends to happen, we talk about alike, and I don't want to be elitist, right? Because, and even looking at the work of Ernie Barnes, you know, I mean, it's still extremely important within the narrative of American art, and specifically Black American art. So I don't want to ever sort of denigrate or look down upon that, any artist. So I think what we need to do, us talented 10th, I think we need to, those of us who have the art jargon and not even us who have the degrees and stuff, we need to make sure that we're doing for others and we're doing for the younger folks. And beyond that divide, the scholarly divide, the generation divide, again, how does that contribute to Black liberation? Him not showing Martin Puryear opposed to a younger emerging artist, how does that conversation and that experience contribute to Black liberation? Yes.
Finish your correlation to your point, please, between...
So when it comes to liberation, we have to teach them. You get what I'm saying? So I'm on the ground every day.
Yeah.
I work at the African Heritage Cultural Arts Center.
That's right.
Which is a performing arts center where we teach kids.
That's right.
And all arts, dance, art, music, drama. We make sure they know that. We make sure that. So that's how we have to do it every day, like you said. I got shot in the back of Black family. We do a lot of things that's liberating or whatever we think is liberating.
But this is...
And I just
stop arguing their argument, their construct.
No, she's not arguing. Yeah.
No.
She's making a point.
I'm adding on to. I'm saying we have to teach. Yeah. When I was preparing for this, okay. I was looking at what the definition. Because do you know how many art students do not know what the hell a canon is? Hmm. They don't even know what a Western canon is. But yet you know what white supremacy is.
Yeah.
We are so busy arguing their constructs that we have not figured out how to create and manifest our own. And when we do, we hoard it.
Yeah,
okay. We hoard it.
I agree, but it's more like making sure everybody gets
it. And then we want to hold ourselves to this talented 10 and elitism. And then we hold it over each other as though this is the whiteness that I'm holding you over to. It is ridiculous. It is straight ridiculous. We are walking around with their flags on our bodies, on our minds, on our chests.
All I was trying to say. Ooh.
Give her fans. Give her fans. Give her fans.
All I was trying to say is that
and Ernie Barnes. Okay, we have another question.
So earlier during the conversation of the elders and the young people and their relationship, you had said something in passing. You said, but the young people aren't listening. The young ones aren't listening. What did you mean by that? Can you go more into where that view comes from? And also, I'm curious, since he says he works with the young people, what is his view?
I just want to chime in on that because as I've been educated for 11 years, and so what I interpret that is, you have a lot of younger, and I'm talking about a generation younger than me, including mine. I graduated from high school in 2000, so I'm pretty young. When we ask students about, or when I ask students about a Marcus Garvey or a Booker T. Washington or even Black history, let alone Black artists, there's a disconnect, and there sometimes is often a disinterest in it. Like, you know, forget it. And I remember Steve Harvey, it was on his show, bless his heart, he said, forget slavery. Forget slavery. Slavery ain't got, we need to be, yes, look it up, right? And so I think that is the regard that a lot of younger folks may have.
So what I meant by that statement is, in the various roles that I had in that organization, okay, I would reach across and challenge some of my peers. Do an artist talk. Come do a workshop. Join us in this exhibition. It's going to be here. It's going to be whatever, this, that. And some of my peers would not entertain exhibiting with this organization. And I truly believe that it is because they wanted to be held in a certain esteem. Right. They wanted to be looked at in a certain way.
White man's ice is cold.
Hmm. White man's ice is colder. That's exactly. No, nobody would tell me that in my face. Hmm. But you know, when you can read, I can read anyway. So my that statement was about them abiding to and adhering to a structure that was not. It's not about African Americans, and it's not for us. It's for and to support white supremacism. So, I'm not all for, you know, that's a whole other debate, the whole Black liberation, and that we have that debate often. I love some white people just as much as I love anybody else. Okay, so, and Lord have mercy, I probably just jumped into a deep hole right there. Yeah, my bad. Lord have mercy. Please, somebody. My point being that. In my opinion, there was a lot of folks that could have reached out, could have reached back, could have reached over, and chose not to because they were afraid of damaging their career or tinting their career or favoring to a Black organization versus doing a show with a white organization.
This exactly, is going to be our last comment, and okay. Then we're going
to something that speaks exactly to what you just said. Before I left Philly, two women, older women, drove to Philadelphia to get a painting I was donating to their auction for Dorsey's Gallery. Dorsey's Gallery has been in Brooklyn for 40 years. It's probably the oldest gallery in Brooklyn. It's in a storefront in a Black neighborhood. It's been running for 40 years. Norman Lewis showed there, everybody else when he wasn't anybody. Well, anyway, they're struggling with younger people, the same conversation. So I called Saul Sachs. A MFA from Yale. It says, Saul, I need you to do a solo show at Dorsey's Gallery. Saul said, Dorsey's? Of course I'll do a solo show. Anything I can do to help continue our institutions. That's what we need to do. Saul Sachs will be doing a solo show at Dorsey's to help him out. And we need to do that. We need to show at our restorations. Yeah. We need to show at all of our institutions. Yeah. I don't care what level you are. I don't care what level you are, you need to reach back and make sure they're there for the people who don't show in Chelsea. That's what we need to do. We need to be conscious. Well, you know, I paint, but I'm a revolutionary. And that's my background, being a revolutionary, not an artist. Art is just a means to help my revolution. Anyway.
Just to add on to your point, not just reaching back to pull people in, but also bringing people to. Bringing people to, because there are a lot of our kids that aren't even aware. So if we're not bringing them to it, it will not continue to exist. So what's next for Delusions of Grandeur? And then we're going to wrap it up because I think that's our time.
Okay. I think in closing, I mean, this was a really good conversation, although it, you know, got a little heated. Well, not even heated. That's what this is all about, right? This is it. This let us know that we are in the right direction. That's it. That's it. And this is still, you know, this is good rhetoric. It is needed. And I just, where we are, we're challenging ourselves and want to challenge other creatives, just what Denny just said, to make sure we don't forget to support Black, to buy Black, to push Black, and to accept and embrace Black, even if it's not within the Western sort of framework. And I think that's where we are, that's what we're about. And because we've been doing art, and it's like, okay, we've hanging it in white galleries and we're getting museum shows, but like, what, again, what, it's about shifting the paradigm, right? And reinventing that paradigm. Not even reinventing, because, I mean, like you say, you've been, brothers been doing that. Brothers and sisters, so let me be correct. Brothers and sisters have been doing that. And so that's where we are. And it's kind of uncomfortable, and it's kind of like a re-indoctrination, but it's like, hey, we got to stick with our people.
But it's taking it to the next level. It's an evolution. So.
It's an
evolution.
Amen. That's it. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm on.
Okay.
That's it.
Thank you all for this conversation. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I want to thank you all for being part of this conversation and for being here today. And that's it. Thank you again.